A few weeks ago, I quickly covered two new AMD announcements. The availability of B550 motherboards, well, sort of, because those boards just seem to be selling out everywhere. And then three new Ryzen CPUs. Well, they're sort of new. So there's the Ryzen 9 3900XT, the Ryzen 7 3800XT, and the Ryzen 5 3600XT. When we published that video, a lot of you were expressing concerns about its pricing, overall performance, and most importantly, what their launch would do to AMD's current lineup. Well, we've got all three of them right over here, and this review is going to follow our usual course. So first, I'll walk you through what has changed in terms of specs, and then go over how the new XT series compared to what's already out there, and then finally wrap up with a metric ton of benchmarks. Also, do keep in mind that a lot of the numbers that you're going to be seeing in just a bit have been updated with new numbers. And the reason for that is over the last few months, there have been some major updates for Windows and some applications that we use. And we're also going to be breaking this review into different segments, just so if you want to get to a particular area, you can just simply hover over the timeline. Now, if your device doesn't support that feature, we'll make sure to leave timestamps in the description down below. So with that out of the way, let's talk about these new XT CPUs right after this. What does it take to experience a compact, high-performance gaming notebook? You want specs that can meet the most demanding tasks, like a fast CPU, up to 32 gigabytes of RAM, ultra-fast NVMe SSD, and RTX graphics. You also want something that's lightweight and easy to carry around. How about a robust optical mechanical keyboard with per-key RGB lighting and a fast 144Hz IPS display? This is the new XPG Xenia gaming notebook. Check it out at the links below and game to the extreme. Okay, so before I get into the juicy details, I think it's important for me to set the stage a little bit. Today actually marks exactly 1 year since Zen 2 and Ryzen 3000 series CPUs were launched. That's right, exactly 1 year has just flown by. So over the course of those 365 days, AMD has proven that it can dominate Intel on almost every front. That includes even after Comet Lake S was announced. If anything, that CPU lineup showed how much ground Intel had to make up for, but AMD still can't sit on its heels either. So that got me thinking, with all these massive successes, a firm lead over the competition, and Zen 3, which is confirmed to be launched later this year, why even bother with the XT series? Well, I have an answer, or more like I have an assumption. It all starts with AMD's use of an enhanced 7-nanometer architecture for these new processors. Basically, over the course of last year, they've been able to fine-tune transistor characteristics to get higher performance through better frequencies without increasing voltage, power consumption, or heat. Well, those refinements will probably be carried over into Zen 3. So this is a great opportunity for a production test run before the updated manufacturing process gets rolled into the next generation of CPUs. Technically, this should mean less headaches down the road while we get some new tech to talk about. But what kind of advancements are we actually going to see right now? Well, like a lot of you said, it's pretty underwhelming, at least on paper. Starting off with the Ryzen 5 3600XT, it gets a 100 megahertz boost to the single core boost clock versus the 3600X. The Ryzen 7 3800XT meanwhile gets a bit more generous bump of 200 megahertz to its single thread clock. And you'll notice the 3700X isn't listed here. That's probably because it's already so close to the 3800X's performance that adding an XT version would make the 3800X kind of pointless. The big boy of this new lineup is the 3900XT. And when lined up against the 3900X, well, yeah, you only get 100 megahertz here again. Now, I really need to highlight one very important thing. All of those are listed as up to, and from our experience, it does take a little bit of work to get those frequencies on a regular basis. First of all, you'll need to find the right mojo with your motherboard settings. On our ASRock X570 Tai Chi, that meant leaving everything to auto, while on the MSI X570 Ace, we needed these settings. You'll also need to make sure that Windows detects enough idle processor time that it parks cores into a completely idle state. In order for that to happen on a regular basis, I found you need to disable always-on applications like Adobe Creative Cloud and the Autodesk app. We also found an issue with Steam, Uplay, and Origin requesting CPU cycles that directly impacted Cinebench single-core results. So once those hoops were jumped through, this is what we actually saw. While AMD claims the 3900XT hits 4.7 GHz, we saw an average sustained frequency of 4.62 GHz. That's still 50 MHz higher than the 3900X though, so it's something, I guess. But when it comes to peak single thread speed, the CPU did indeed hit 4.75 GHz every now and then. Switching to multi-threaded workloads, AMD doesn't claim any improvements, but when averaged out over the course of a 20-minute Maya run, there's a really, really small 20 megahertz advantage. Let's see where that comes from, since it impacts the behavior of all the XT CPUs. There were quite a few times throughout the all-core test where the cores are consistently boosting 15 to 50 megahertz higher. This will probably cause a very, very narrow advantage for the 3000 XT CPUs in some applications, but not enough to make a visible difference. This pattern repeated itself almost identically for the 3800XT, though it has a slightly larger single-core advantage over the 3800X since its weighted boost clock has been increased by 200 MHz. The 3600XT is a copy and paste of that too, with higher peaks but very similar averages compared to the 3600X. So with all of that taken into mind, there isn't going to be a huge performance leap over the non-XT CPUs, but there is a huge price gap between them. Like a lot of you brought up in the last video, AMD's retail partners have already started to lower prices on the 3900X, the 3800X, and the 3600X. So let's check out how they all line up. Basically, what you're going to see is the XT variants hitting the same prices as their predecessors did a year ago. The main problem is those reduced prices now put the 3900X at $420, the 3800X at $320, and the 3600X at just $220. Meanwhile, the 3700X will continue to be at $275. But when you start looking at things, paying between 30 and 80 bucks for a few extra megahertz seems like a pretty raw deal. I should also mention that the 3900XT and 3800XT don't have coolers, while the 3600XT includes a rate spire in its box. But before I jump into any conclusions, let's head into the benchmarks. You can pause here if you want to read through the complete system specs. Starting things off with single-threaded performance, and yeah, it looks like there is a small bump when moving from the X series to the new 3000XTs. It isn't much, at only around 5%, but it's there in this one case. Things change when moving on to purely multi-threaded benchmarks, and this is something we'll see pretty much throughout both synthetic and real-world tests. Basically, the 3900XT, the 3800XT, and the 3600XT don't offer any tangible benefits in CPU-intensive applications. Meanwhile, in programs that are slightly less multi-threaded or use a GPU for secondary processing, the benefits are a bit higher. And I mean a bit. This is a result of a higher sustained speeds over the course of each test, but honestly, this doesn't amount to much in real world. In gaming, pretty much all these mid-level and higher-end CPUs align with one another. But if you dive down a bit into the results, the differences in average frame rates between the X and the XT series was literally nothing. There was a slight bump in 1% lows for the faster CPUs. It wouldn't make a visible impact in gameplay, but after multiple runs, it was there. Another thing that AMD mentioned is the XT series should see more of an advantage in games that are sensitive to frequencies. We didn't see any of that here, but maybe it comes down to which titles we're using and the fact that every one of them is set to the highest details. Power consumption showed really minor increases for all these processors except the 3900XT, which was a bit high. Personally, I think this is because the 3900X we have in the office tends to run really cool and seems to be an overall more efficient chip compared to some of the others that we've come across. Either way, all these numbers are pretty much within the margin of error. Well, guys, a lot of you mentioned that these refresh processors from AMD seemed pretty underwhelming since they don't offer a huge leap in terms of performance, but they also cost a lot more than the CPUs that are currently in the market right now. And unfortunately, that's the conclusion that we've come to. Based on what AMD has been bringing to the table over the last year, the 3000 XT series just look like a poor value. I mean, look, when you look at the current lineup, the non-XT CPUs are at their lowest price point right now, which is amazing. It almost feels like AMD was expecting their existing refresh processors to be able to achieve higher sustained speeds, but that just didn't happen, so they were sort of forced to launch them anyway. As for the competition against the Comet Lake lineup, well, I'm just gonna voice some caution for AMD. In general, Ryzen 3000 processors offer a phenomenal value when compared to anything in Team Blue's lineup, but these new CPUs almost wipe out any pricing advantage. I mean, sure, the XTs still win by a long shot in many productivity applications, and yet many Intel CPUs tend to be an overall better choice for gaming, even if they're attached to an outdated platform. A few price cuts for Intel could really ruin the XT series, at least in gaming. So here's the deal. If you're in the market for a new AMD CPU, skip the XT series, because the small benefits that you gain in terms of performance, doesn't seem to be justifiable considering how expensive they are compared to the current Ryzen lineup. I would save that money and just invest that into a better GPU or storage. So on that note, thank you so much for watching, and I'll talk to you guys in the next one.